Hello and welcome to the O's. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Not again. We can't do the song every time.
Hello and welcome to the OC Men. Hi. This is the eighth episode of the podcast where every week my two friends and I watch an episode of the mid-2000s primetime teen dramedy, The OC, and discuss what we just watched. I'm JT.
I'm Russell.
And I'm Jamie.
And we are
the OC Men.
Our goal for this podcast is to figure out just why I love this show so much. Yeah, we killed that one. And to see how two guys completely new to the series react to each episode in depth. Today's episode was The Rescue from Season 1, the Madame Bovary episode. Ooh. Before we dive into it, I just want to recap the story of the OC up to this point.
I'd call it the Evil Julie episode.
Ooh.
The Evil Julie episode.
It's a metaphor.
Underprivileged teen criminal Ryan has been adopted by the affluent Orange County Cohen family. They travel to Tijuana with local love interest Marissa and Summer, but things go awry when Marissa catches Luke backing that ass up with another girl. because of this discovery, as well as the impending divorce of her parents, Marissa overdoses on pain meds and tequila and is found unconscious by Ryan and company in an alley. And that is where the episode leaves off.
Ryan and Company sounds like that Disney movie about Oliver.
Oliver and Company, yes. It does have most of the words of that, yes. That's true. Why would I worry?
That was good.
Why would I care? So this episode actually opens up with in the Cohen's kitchen with the gang back from Tijuana. It's early morning and they're worried about Marissa possibly dying.
I feel like they missed an opportunity of showing them getting back and trying to enjoy the rest of their weekend with sort of a Weekend at Bernie's situation of just keeping Marissa propped up, bringing her on adventures. But
I feel like that's the wrong tone for this.
All right, that's fair. That's fair. We'll just agree to disagree.
Okay.
But they jumped way ahead.
We did miss a sweet airlift.
Out of Mexico?
Yeah.
That almost feels like they had to steal her.
That'd cost money to do stuff with helicopters.
So. I suppose.
But it would be a cool scene to have the Coens come and rescue them from Mexico and have
her rappel from a helicopter.
What was like?
Sandy's riding on a surfboard and just kicking up waves as he throws her over his shoulder.
Luke just jumps his truck over the border.
His shirt's off. Tell me his shirt's off.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Say it slowly.
It's just unbuttoned halfway.
No, it's off. Though I thought it was an interesting tension-breaking move to have her. Is she dead in the last episode? In the very beginning of the next episode, we know that she's in the hospital recovering. Mm-hmm. She still might die, but I thought it was interesting not to have the next episode open up with, after the escape, when she might be dead, it opens up with, they're back from TJ. She's been in the hospital. They're just waiting for, I thought that was an interesting tension break as opposed to leading us on a little bit more.
I guess we do get the scene of them sitting around watching the phone, right? Where you're trying to wait.
But you kind of know she's back in the hospital at this point,
I guess,
right?
You know she's at the hospital, but you don't know if she's out of the woods.
Okay.
But they do relieve that tension before the credits. I mean, that's okay, like they're all just sitting around. No one wants to eat breakfast. Everyone just wants to sit and wait to hear something. Mope.
Yeah, they're talking about no one wants to eat breakfast. Kirsten mentions they have three sesame and one plain bagel. Yeah. Are the Coens the three sesames and Ryan the one plain?
But he's not plain, though. I feel like, if anything, he would be the sesame. Yeah.
I actually, when she was setting that up, I was like, is this going to be, should I pay attention to who takes the plain bagels and say something about their character?
Yeah.
And then just no one ate the bagels.
Well, there's three Coens and one Ryan.
Yeah.
Also, Ryan didn't change clothes. Like, everyone else changed clothes, but he was wearing the same clothes. So I'm guessing he doesn't shower.
Solidarity.
He's got a pool house. He just jumps in the pool. Though, again, this will be me not noticing anything anybody wears, as always. Okay, so we set up some conflict for the episode in this kitchen. We got both Ryan and Sandy are starting something new. They're moving on up each. Ryan's going to meet with the dean about possibly going to harbor school with Seth, and Sandy is starting his new fancy job.
So it's harbor. I kept thinking they were saying Harvard at some point, and that makes... Okay, tons of sense.
And I feel like they did say Harvard when they were like, you could go to Ivy League schools like Harbor. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wait, what?
No, they're at Harbor School, which is a preparatory school for, it's a launching point to things like UCLA and Harvard. And
USC, kind of, I think.
USC and Harvard. Yeah.
And they are the Pirates, which I was curious as what their mascot was, because one time Luke was wearing a shirt that said Comets.
The Comets, yeah, they're not the Comets, they're the Pirates. Have you ever heard that old song like Comet? It makes you vomit and makes your something turn green. Comet. It tastes like Listerine, so drink some Comet and vomit today.
No, I know the theme. I know the song that you're singing, but
my mom said when she was a kid, they do like a version of it where it's like you drink Comet detergent or whatever.
What the fuck?
And it would make your lips turn green and make you vomit. So drink some Comet and vomit today.
Why would you just drink poison?
I don't know why that was. I mean, she grew up in like the late 50s, early 60s as a kid. Like, they didn't have much.
They love drinking poison.
They didn't have much to do other than
no music. Internet. So what do you do?
I am now worried for all our listeners of the OC Men. So please, I want to make sure you're alive and not ODing on Comet. So tweet at us, hashtag didn't drink the Comet.
We do not support drinking poison on this podcast.
Did not make me vomit today. Okay, so at the end of this opening scene, the phone rings.
We're still in the
office. And it seems like they just watch it ring and then the scene ends. So my question is, they answer that phone, right?
Yes.
We just don't show
obviously, when Kiki sees Jimmy's name, she's going to pick up.
And so the phone call is actually from... from Jimmy, I guess,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So a phone call is from Jimmy from the hospital, and the Coens rush to the hospital to check on Marissa. I don't know why he called them exactly. I guess she's out of the woods. She's not awake. She did wake up.
Yeah, I think he woke up. She woke up, but just before they showed up, she fell back asleep.
Okay, so she's
convenient.
She's not dead. She's just sleeping.
Just lazy.
In a coma,
how many days has it been? Yeah, I mean, I'm not too familiar with mixing tequila and painkillers, but it feels like she should have bounced back from this a bit quicker.
Well, maybe it is the next morning. Do we know for a fact it's not just the next morning?
I don't know.
Maybe it's just all night she was.
That's a crazy fucking night.
Well, because also, I mean, it's a staple of the soap opera, right? The character in a coma. Mm-hmm. I always wonder if it's a budget thing or just like if they want to do other projects, they don't have to act a lot in that, or is it just attention?
Or they get pregnant sometimes.
Something like that. So I'm wondering with this, in real life, do people just go in like day-long comas a lot in real life, or is that only a television thing?
I know that you can medically induce a coma, and I feel like more times that's what it's usually like. If someone fucks up their brain and they're in danger of hurting themselves. He's been liking all of our podcasts.
I know he has because he's such a great guy.
Which one do we call him out by name? I can remember which episode.
I thought we edited that out.
The sloth in Ice Age? No, it's still in there.
Oops.
Yeah, it's still in there. And I just feel bad when I listen. Like, oh, I made fun of Chris for no reason.
He's a big supporter. He's a great guy. Asshole.
Oh, look at me. I'm a great guy. I'm so nice to everyone. Everyone likes me. Ugh.
So Marissa doesn't have brain damage.
Yeah, well, not from taking the pills and drinking the tequila.
Yikes. I don't know. It always feels very convenient. The same way they always do that in fiction where people get punched in the head and knocked out for a convenient amount of time.
When in actuality, if you get knocked, like, you know, Giles and Buffy kept getting punched and he'd be knocked out for hours. I think I read in real life, if you get knocked out, the punch, you're going to be maybe 40 seconds.
Yeah.
Any more than that, you're going to start getting brain damage after a minute.
Exactly.
So like, yeah, in real life, Giles has been knocked silly.
Well, he's messed with some dark art, so it's probably evening him out.
There we go.
Mm-hmm.
So they go to the hospital.
And everything's fine and happy, and everyone loves that they came to show up. And
Julie welcomes them with open arms.
Well, Jimmy's cool that they're there. Jimmy seems very kind of like, hey, guys, thanks for coming by. I'm overwhelmed. Thank you for coming.
Because they're the only people who are nice to him in the town.
Yeah. And Julie kind of comes in like a wrecking ball.
It definitely felt like they made a choice with her character this episode where she's just going to change gears and just like, all right, it's villain time. Let's fucking do this.
She turned a corner. She's now it's safe to say she's the main villain.
But is she justified?
Good.
Here's, I don't know if this is going to happen, but what I hope is going to happen. So they've teamed up. Jimmy and Julie have a past, or Jimmy and Kiki have a past. Also, Sandy has this past with this Rachel character. So that means in my mind, Julie has a past with someone. And I imagine coming from Riverside, that person is going to be like a not as fun Ryan character. And she has bad memories with this kind of Ryan character. And so when she sees her daughter getting with this Ryan character, she wants to protect her from this bad guy Ryan character. And so I think that's all she's trying to do, but she also doesn't realize the goodness that is in Ryan's heart.
She's also terrified for her. They actually bring that out later in the episode. She's just terrified about everything, so she's making crazy decisions.
Yeah.
They're also showing that she is very worried about losing what they've worked up to at this point. You know, she came from nothing. She has all this wealth, and she's so scared about losing this type of stuff. I feel like they're giving her some reasons why she's reacting so extremely.
And definitely, the point about her forbidding her from seeing Ryan, that feels like something that's done out of fear. But a lot of this episode feels like Marissa saying, I don't understand why she's still so mad that yes. I tried to kill myself. Like, that's a big deal. Like, you OD'd on pain pills in Mexico.
And we get the psychologist talking to her, and she's like, I don't understand why my mother thinks I'm trouble, but they list all the things that might equal troubling. I think they equal to just somewhat rebellious teenager, but she should at least be able to see that viewpoint. But I mean, I guess yes. that's asking from a young person that is emotional about situation, like that's asking a lot to say, hey, can't you calmly and rationally see both sides? And the mother who is keeping things from what you want, can't you see her side of it? That's asking a lot, I guess.
Yeah, there would be no drama.
Julie Cooper's, Marissa's mother, forbids Ryan from seeing Marissa. It is his fault that she is indisposed, according to Julie. Mm-hmm. And she threatens getting whoever, the authorities, to send Ryan back to juvie if he actually does go and try to hang out and see Marissa.
Julie used a line that someone tried to assassinate Luke, and it's crazy for me to think about Donnie as an assassin. It's not what he was attempting to do.
Yeah,
that is not who he is. He's not some master hitman.
Yeah, she's using heightened rhetoric to make her point there, right? She's like, no, not only it wasn't just like an accidental shot like it was, and it wasn't just some guy getting angry at a party. No, it was an assassination attempt.
Mm-hmm. But I think
she's using it politically almost in her, or not politically, she's using it rhetorically in her argument. Yeah.
Yes. In a lot of ways, it felt like this episode was kind of setting up another status quo in sort of shifting a little bit, and we're changing the relationship between, it looked like at the beginning of this that Luke was going to be removed from the picture. And so, you know, you can't have your main character just be super happy and get the girl that he wants in the seventh episode or the eighth episode. So I like that it was kind of the shift of, okay, instead of Luke being the big obstacle, now we're going to introduce the evil stepmother as the, who's the actual mother.
They did a good job not having that next hurdle come out of nowhere. They set up Julie as a potential hurdle until this episode where she takes over from Luke, and now it's made perfect sense.
Yeah, yeah.
As opposed to maybe a less subtle show might have Luke be the problem, and then once he's done, introduce a new problem.
Exactly.
This is set up and foreshadowing.
No, I thought it worked really well, and I was kind of embracing it. I think it's Melinda Clark, right? That's the actress. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, I think she is definitely looks like she's having a lot of fun, and I think she's a great foil for everybody.
So we talked about it a little bit, but she does have a little bit of a point, right? Maybe from her point of view, can you see it from her point of view, seeing Ryan come in, and now her daughter didn't want to show up to Cotillion. Her daughter doesn't. It goes to TJ without her knowing, and does she have a leg to stand on there?
There are other things going on, but those aren't the only things. I don't get why she lumps them all as the sole reason this is happening, because that doesn't make sense.
I think I've seen that a lot I can't think of an example from my parents, but I feel like people that I knew, their parents, if something bad happens, one, the first thing the parent wants to do is find a reason why, and they want to find a reason how to fix it. And then secondly, they don't want it to be entirely the fault of their kid. So they want to find the easy. And so the argument that she makes about, like, in my eyes, my daughter was fine and happy and perfect, and then as soon as you moved to town, she started getting all these weird ideas. That's not wrong in her eyes. I mean, in Marissa's eyes, she's always
been feeling that. From her perspective, Julie is being consistent, probably, and she's being honest, but she just has a wrong way of looking at
it. Yeah, and then I think like her character kind of devolves into, you know, lying and sneaking around and forging things, and we'll get to that in a second.
But Ryan isn't the one who introduced her to punk music. Whoever introduced her to punk music probably set her down on this path.
Did Jimmy? No, Jimmy doesn't seem like a punk guy. I wonder where she got to start with that. Awesome. Which one of her friends or family? I guess you can find it on your
own. Jimmy just has an exploited tattoo.
Napster.
Ooh.
Napster was around then. Yeah. And so after the hospital, does anything else happen? Julie shoos them away and warns Ryan.
Ryan's not wearing a necklace anymore.
One of the things that I liked, and this is sort of a theme for the episode, was that Julie gets in Ryan's face, and Ryan actually says, not like in a disrespectful way, but actually like looks her in the eye and talks back to her. And that, like, kind of defending him a little bit, and like, you know, I know you want this to be my fault, but it's not my thing. And I think that's a subtle shift in Ryan's character, where it felt like he was usually just sort of the strong, silent type.
Like, he just take the abuse.
Yeah, and just bear the brunt and be like, yeah, whatever.
He still does that to some extent here.
But it feels like there's specific moments throughout this episode of him actually talking. It's him with the dean, him at the very end, and all that good stuff. So I like to see that as a shift for his character.
Never knew he could say so many words. He was saving it up for a good reason.
Okay, so the next scene is the Harbor School meeting, where Ryan goes in to talk to the dean of Harbor School about being allowed to study there. It opens with a kind of a impressive shot of the campus, and Ryan is super impressed by a guy skateboarding past, I guess. But mm-hmm. from what I can tell, that was the focal point of that shot. I'm like, what, did nobody skateboard at your old school? I mean, you don't have to have a nice campus to have somebody skateboard there.
Well, it feels like a college. It looks like a college more than a high school. And so
yeah, that seemed to make sense. He was impressed by the tennis courts and the swimming pool. He just had a hoop, which is called back with Sandy. Sandy also only had a hoop at his old law firm.
I love it.
Yeah, that fucking callback, that stuff is what I am loving about this show. Like it's such a simple thing of them just showing like, oh, Sandy and Ryan are similar dudes, but like those things, that writing is so nice and tight and fun.
It was they both had hoops at their old place, and they both had had to get mugshots.
Yes.
The new school.
End of the episode when they said that mugshot episode, I laughed out loud. That was great.
Yeah. I also noticed Ryan said, so this is school or something like that. I was like, oh, right. I knew what he meant. Like, so this is your school, basically. But it was almost like Ryan be like, so this is what school is, huh? I've never been to one of these schools before you've been talking about.
And yet he still has perfect test scores.
Exactly. He's amazing. I love Dr. Kim's line when she sees Seth. We're talking about Seth always getting shit. And he goes, Seth, always interesting to see you.
Yeah, what the fuck does that mean?
Such an underhanded thing to say.
Yeah, two questions. Was it supposed to be this kind of passive-aggressive thing, like you're a weird fucking kid, yeah. Seth? So why did she need to fucking say that to him? In case you forgot, you're a weirdo. And number two, how come Kirsten doesn't say anything to that shit? Her son's getting, like, you know, subtly kind of obviously bullied by the dean, and she's like, I'm not going to say anything.
Well, she doesn't say anything because Seth gives her shit all the time, and so she's probably pretty pleased gets something back. Yeah. But I feel like also everyone loves Sandy. Everyone loves Kiki. Kiki's dad owns OC, so everyone's pretty much cool with all them. But then imagine Seth. Seth, who we know growing up in this place, acting this way. He's probably been acting this way all his life, and that is not fun to be around. And everyone is probably just sick and tired of
that creepy
shit.
Kid that just like skulks around and looks in windows.
And just like, oh, god damn it.
Messing with like kittens and stuff around the neighborhood. How about this? Ryan and Seth are talking about Ryan and Seth are talking about this issue with Marissa and Julie, and Seth says to Ryan, just tell her it's Luke's fault, basically. And Ryan responds with, I'm just glad she's okay. And that's kind of like the end of that discussion. And my question is, does this frustrate you when you see this in TV shows or movies? I think I brought this up earlier. It's like that thing that happens in Lost, maybe, where it's just like, really, if Ryan would just explain the situation, it might could fix the problem, but they it's almost like a sense of honor or something. And he's like, yes. No, I'm just glad she's okay. And they leave it at that. But in real life, wouldn't you actually just explain the case?
You've got to have integrity. You don't rat someone out. You just suck it up and take it. It's not up to him to reveal that shit. That's not his story to tell.
Fair enough.
If someone is upset about it without knowing the whole truth, you just let them be upset about it. It's not up to him to say, it wasn't me, because that's just going to make him look bad.
She's not going
to
believe it anyway. Yeah. You know? Though on the other hand, like, okay, so you're blaming me for the near death and, you know, possibly like serious injury of this person. On the other hand of that, if you play devil's advocate, it could be, I don't want people, you know, if you never defend yourself in court, people assume it's because you're not, you know, innocent probably. If you're innocent, why isn't he trying to defend himself? I feel like I've heard that about like in Making a Murder and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, why didn't he take the stand and say he's innocent if he is? So my thing is, if she died and everyone just knows it's Ryan, he just takes it to his grave, I'll never tell anyone that I was not the cause of her death.
Well, he's not the only one who knows. Summer also knows. Seth also knows.
Seth could tell people.
Luke knows. Mm-hmm. So it's people know, but it's not his story to tell, I feel.
Yeah.
It feels like they could all be bros and step up to him.
Like, Marissa OD'd on purpose. That is a thing she did. It shouldn't be up to Ryan to explain why she did it. Mm-hmm. It should be up to her to come clean with her mother about what's going on. Like, that's the good thing that should happen.
No, that's
that's the healthy thing that should happen.
That's a fair point that I didn't think of, and that's on me, because I guess I just, because I know Marissa from this whole series, I'm just, she's not going to just tell her mother, like, no, it was me, it wasn't Ryan. Like, maybe she will later in this series, but like right now she's not going to, she'll just be like, oh, mom, don't be mad at Ryan, but still not say, no, it was all my fault and these are the reasons.
Yep, yep.
She's very passive in these early episodes.
Not understanding why people are.
She's constantly baffled that anyone's loves her or that anyone's mad at her, that anyone's upset with. Just constantly baffled by other people's reactions to things she does.
Yeah.
I found. Also completely baffled as, you know, or just not baffled. Just seems like she's very inward focused in a lot of ways. Not inward. She's very focused on the interior. In that, you know, just, I gotta call Ryan. He's gotta stop. He's gotta stop studying to come help me. I gotta call Ryan. He's gotta stop taking his test to come help me. I gotta call my friends to come help me. I gotta make my friends look for me in Mexico. If we go to Tijuana, it's gotta be all about me. It seems very much, she very much thinks about herself. But it's a strange thing though, because it's ironically she does that. But then she also, you haven't seen so much of it, but I've talked about, she always focuses on the person that needs more, especially the male character that needs help. Mm-hmm. That comes into bigger and bigger in later episodes. So it's this this almost like selfishness mixed with this very like nurturing, wounded puppy, I must, you know, nurture aspect.
Is that why she wants to move in with her dad?
It seems now she wants to move in with the dad because he's the one being,
he's the most pathetic of everyone.
Yes, I think we can all agree that Jimmy is the most pathetic.
So I definitely want to talk more about you know, Ryan going, meeting the dean, sitting down and stuff. Most of the Sandy going to work stuff isn't worth talking about that much,
as last episode proved,
right? But yeah, there's one thing where, and we can even cut this out if this is not going anywhere.
Yep.
He says, some of these cases, so he's looking at all the new cases, right? And he says, sarcastically, she goes, yeah, scintillating, right? And he goes, yeah, in the purest form of the word. And that felt like that was supposed to be wordplay. Like when you looked up the definition of scintillating, it actually means, you know, like shallow and empty. But I looked it up and it just means either, you know, lurid or interesting, but it could also mean flashing briefly or sparkling.
That might be what it meant. Like it doesn't, it's very flashy, but it has no substance to it, and it blinks out really quickly, like burns out bright type situation.
I guess that's probably what he was going
or
with.
You could, you'd be doing a play off the word sin that is in the word scintillating, like these people are sinning.
That's what I mean.
Or just overstating the irony of it, like, yeah, in the purest sense, like it's so obviously not scintillating. That's what he's, you know, he's,
If it flashes brightly and then no longer matters, those cases aren't going to be a big deal in the long run. He's not going to be doing anything major. He's not going to be helping anyone. It's just going to be working on tiny little bullshit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Also, Rachel, this episode, I realized that to me, she just seems like she's Anna grown up. Like, that seems like the same exact character.
She's gone.
Yes.
Like, as in she was teaching confidence, or like that she was written to be the perfect match?
She is confident, and she seems to be like, kind of, not above it, but she's like, she knows it's kind of ridiculous to be corporate, but she's kind of like cool with it. Just like Anne knows it's ridiculous to go to,
to do
the
date,
the debutante's ball, but she's kind of doing like, it's a similar, I think whoever, maybe the writers of this show have a certain way that they think of as a cool, confident lady. And so they're writing both. They're supposed to be positive. They're supposed to be attractive. They're supposed to be confident, supposed to be cool. And that's their like go-to for like a cool, confident lady. Maybe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But, no, that makes,
well, I know there's definitely a theme, both male and female, of main characters that are feeling like they're outsiders and having a lot of just existential angst as a result of feeling like they're not fitting in. And so coming up with characters who can sort of meet with them.
Yeah, okay.
That have those same feelings.
They exist, but on both sides.
But are better at playing, at existing. And,
they don't have the existential problem that's causing the main characters. They exist in the same space, but they don't have the problems with identity that causes for the mains. Yeah,
absolutely. So I can see why that would be an attractive match for any of those characters. Makes sense. So anyway, that was the only Sandy stuff. We can go back to Ryan sitting down and talking to the dean. One of the things I liked when they were sitting down, when it was Kirsten and Ryan, is there was sort of, you know, there hasn't been too many scenes of Ryan and Kirsten really since the Model Home episode where they got to interact together.
Talk about some architecture.
Yeah, yeah. And so there's a scene where the dean is sort of being very dismissive and being like, you know, I think maybe you should go back. And Kirsten goes to bat for him and sort of speaks up. And Ryan kind of does a little eyebrow raise of like, okay, I'm adjusting my... And then...
His real mom maybe didn't do that type of thing for him. Probably didn't show up for these type of meetings.
So it's equal parts like, yes, surprise and then approval. And then she kind of countered, the dean counters, and then Ryan speaks up for himself, and then we get a scene of Kirsten looking at him and sort of being impressed, eyebrows raised, being like, okay,
maybe,
well,
maybe Seth would not have done the similar thing in that situation. He's like, oh, this is kind of like a kid I always wanted.
So while Kirsten and Ryan are meeting with the dean, we've got Seth outside.
Summer, right?
Yeah.
They're hanging out at the lunch table.
So, you know, we all know that, like, Summer loves it when we've got confident Seth, And he does this move that the podcast will love me indicating with the hands, where she walks up and he kind of like points to the chair. He's like, yeah, sit. And I'm like, oh man, that's like supreme baller move.
Well, he also, what does he not do this time that he's done every other time when they first walked up? He
said, hi, I'm Seth Cohen.
Yeah. He doesn't do the full introduction, and they do a hey, the Ryan Marissa move, which we got earlier, by the way, in the hospital when Sandy comes in, he says, hey, and then Jimmy says, hey, Sandy.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, also went Brian and Marissa talking.
Yeah, that later, yeah.
That's it. At so 15 minutes in, I marked
three different hey-hays that I can tell.
Hey.
We're the monkeys. You can watch this episode for free on Hulu, but I guess whatever copy of the episode I had.
For instructional use only? Mine did it too.
So was this, this felt like a very serious after-school special episode. Oh, so was it used for teaching in high school? Because I saw The Breakfast Club in high school in that sort of way, and like there's a scene towards the end that felt very Breakfast Club-y between Seth and Summer, and so like that flashed for informational purposes only flashed a few times, and so it seems like, did they show this in high schools to be like, hey, if you're going through shit and you want to fucking drink a bunch of tequila and painkillers, don't, because no one will be happy and you'll have to be rescued.
This feels like the type of episode that nowadays would have a disclaimer at the end that said, if you're feeling this way, these are the numbers to call. You see those in episodes of television you see now.
I've seen those
a couple times. If they mention the word suicide, it'll have this thing at the end to give information to people who need help. It feels like this episode would have that. But would you use this episode or the one before this, The Escape, as the...
feels like you'd have to do tandem. Both. Because it's either one, you don't see it happen, or two, if you just watch The Escape, you would just think she ends with her dying, which maybe is a good message.
Maybe it's more
effective. So don't be her. Instead of like, if you do this, then everyone will fight over you and you'll have hunky boys trying to help you at every turn.
Hunky.
But anyway, it seems like Seth and Summer feel like they've turned a corner at their relationship, and they are now in a new, maybe they're not dating or anything, but like they're at a new level where they're closer to being equals. They're talking to each other, even though, you know, Summer's still not completely unembarrassed by Seth, but they are now, they are just like, they have a rapport now. They will talk.
She remembers his name.
She at least remembers his name.
They've gotten that far.
She's remembered his name this whole time. She just fucking with him. I
100% agree.
If someone, every time they meet me, introduces themselves to me, I'm going to make it purpose. My sole thing is going to be to not remember their name.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We've talked a lot about Summer being sort of like, not one note, but sort of being a consistent character.
Kind of representative of like the vapid OC populism.
Yeah, but like this one, she was a bummer. And like, I don't like sad Summer. I don't want her to be upset. I like it when she's happy. Her being all down about this was no fun.
Yeah, she, because she's like, she's got like a spirit to her, right? And seeing Rachel Bilson play more lower energy and stuff is, I feel like that's not what you want to see. You want to see her happy and smiling and making jokes and being like feisty and things like that.
I'm ready for them to go to Six Flags, though. I'm ready for that episode.
You're doing the dance right now.
Take off the bald cap.
No. I thought this was interesting when they're talking about this
banana.
When Seth and Summer are talking talking about this banana, my cousin, if you remember the first episode.
My cousin banana.
Summer says to Seth that it's weird to be in school. Everybody has no idea what happened, which I thought was interesting. She hasn't been oriented really as an outsider this whole time, but this is kind of doing that to her now. She's kind of joining the gang, joining the Scooby gang, being part of the group. We're seeing her saying like, there's this thing that now she is, she has with Seth and Summer and Marissa, Seth and Ryan and Marissa, that sets her apart from everybody else. That has no idea all this crazy shit that happened in TJ, how Marissa almost died, this thing that brought them close together. No one else can know. It's just for us. It's just weird to be back. I thought that was really interesting that she picked up on that.
Sco CB game. Gang. But yeah, you're right. Summer talks about she'll never speak to Luke or Holly again. And like, whenever we've seen her, those are the people she's hanging out with. Yeah. Those are the parties she's going to. So I didn't think she is definitely now an outsider now.
She has to hang out with Ryan and Seth. I mean, who else she's going to hang out with?
Stepmomster. Do you guys think her stepmom was upset she didn't come back with any pills?
I think the stepmom has been portrayed as someone that is always zonked out. But I guess those pills are how she gets herself zonked out. So maybe she didn't even notice.
Zonks!
Zonks!
Do we meet her parents ever?
Only
Ben Stiller?
When Ben Stiller comes in the final season, do you meet her parents? They're cool fuckers, but no, we haven't met them yet.
Okay.
That's all. I mean, what do you want me to? Yeah, you meet her parents.
Ha. And it's Ben Stiller plays both of the roles. They're
this bitch. You were just a dog walker.
It's Ben Stiller.
Okay. So
that's a callback.
Okay, so that's a callback. Summer shuns him when cheerleaders see them, but feels bad. No, I'm just reading the note out word for word now. So they're having a decent conversation, Seth and Summer, and then some cheerleaders walk by, and Summer kind of looks away and has to pretend like she doesn't know him, basically. So things are starting to change, but she's pulled, you know, there's a try-fail cycle. She's trying to adjust to the new way things are in the hero's journey type stuff. So she's starting to become friends with him, but pulls back and fails again. She's, you know, pulled back within herself. And she kind of apologetically looks over her shoulder as she walks away while Seth is basically like, oh, we're going back to this again? Okay.
I like once to mirror his baller move of pointing to her to sit down. When he sees he does that, he kind of like waves her off. It's just sort of like, yep, you go now.
I get how it goes.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So yeah, that was good. I think that was a good setup for their character arc. So I liked it.
He also formally asked her out on a date.
Oh, yeah.
Very smoothly, too.
But it wasn't doing like a move or anything. No. Like he was just being honest. Like, hey, we've been through this stuff. We're cool now. Let's go get a movie. And she's like, nope. Yeah. So does she want to at this point? She wants to, right? She wants to go to a movie with Seth, right?
She does. But I do wonder how much of it has to do with the fact she's just feeling very abandoned and very much like grasping to him as the one life vest on the sinking ship of her social life.
Has he done anything that you guys would be like, okay, that makes sense why she'd now have a crush on him? I mean, I guess she knew about her squirrel and her story.
Yeah, he has a lot of creepy stuff. Nothing romantic.
It's true.
It felt like last episode there was a lot of, I think that was the whole point of last episode, of showing them interacting together in a way that feels realistic. So, you know, I don't think that they necessarily...
Would that be the flirting?
Oh yeah, nope, 100%. That was all flirting.
Have we seen some white hot flirting going on this episode? steaming pile of flirt.
They didn't get a chance to flirt. I think maybe he was offering to flirt on her a bit, but okay. She was she rejected.
Sandy and Rachel though, we still a continuation of the flirting from last episode.
Yeah. And we'll continue to not talk about it because it's boring.
Yeah.
Now it's
their
good.
Flirting is silent, and potentially deadly. Next scene is Marissa in the hospital. Marissa's pretending to sleep and overhears Julie arguing with Jimmy that she should have sole custody of their children, including Marissa and her sister. And so she makes a call to Summer for help at this point, right?
Yeah. And it also kind of Julie stepping up the villain game that she's been establishing in the first of just now she's blaming Jimmy for it. Yeah, trying to steal
everyone but herself.
Yeah.
She's the evil queen who wants her daughter's soul.
Yeah.
She's the... Now, I won't bring up Addie of the Julii again, but it's almost the exact scene in Rome where this happens.
Is it like Friday Night Lights, you guys? Come.
Yes, also like Buffy. Ryan's also trying to... so now Ryan's trying to study.
As Seth just watches him.
Seth watches and just continually talks by himself constantly.
So he keeps interrupting, and Ryan keeps being like, no, listen... But then he just goes back to the resting state, the state that they want of just Seth sitting there and watch. That still seems weird. He should be like, you need to get up and walk out of the house. But yes, he would not stop talking about himself.
Well, I mean, if Ryan had any questions about the test, he'd have to ask Seth about it. It's his old test.
That's true. It seems like he is smart. Like, they gave his class list and he's like taking every hard class at the school.
Yeah. All that AP stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, Ryan can, even though Seth wants him to go to school with him, he needs to study to do that. He's annoying him so much that Ryan can't actually study. But then Marissa, you find out who she's called. She's called Ryan, I guess, not Summer. So she calls Ryan to come talk to her. Now she's woken up and she wants to, I guess, talk to him about the emotions her mother made her feel, I suppose.
I don't understand that, but I guess people would want that.
So rather than talk to him on the phone, he has to, you know, hang up and go see her in person, which I guess it's a thing people did in 2003. They wouldn't just text about it. They would actually call, say, yes, I'll be there, and they come and talk in person.
It could have just been like, she sends a frowny emoticon.
And he sends a poop back.
he sends a hug emoticon with a poop and an eggplant.
And she sends the laughing so hard I'm crying, but she meant it to be just crying, but she doesn't know her emoticons yet.
It's still new.
It's the word of the year for Oxford Dictionary. I can't remember. One dictionary gave it the word of the year, the laughing so hard I'm crying.
Thanks, Oxford. Mm-hmm.
emoji. Okay, so he stops. Like, of course, he stops studying and runs right to the hospital to talk to Marissa.
And so now they finally get to say hey in person together.
And when he gets to the hospital, hey, hey. Mm-hmm.
They got to be aware of it. They got to be doing it on purpose. That has to be. They don't call back to actual things and then also do that. That's now just a recurring thing. Summer says ew, so they know that this is a thing.
And they did it. They made a point of saying, ew, this bathroom's so ew. So they know they're doing that.
Yep. Yeah. Oh, we get a good one this episode. But yes, we get the classic scene of Ryan having to hide in the bathroom while the mom is in.
I feel like I've seen that in lots of movies. If there's a hospital, at some point someone will hide in the bathroom door.
I feel, you know, it's also like you see it if someone's in the bedroom and they got to hide in the closet while the
parents. Yeah, they go to the hospital bathroom to hide.
Yes. Just run out the window down the street to the hospital.
That's where Marissa says a nice line about last episode. I just wanted to escape. And the last episode is titled The Escape.
Oh, the titular line.
Mm, the titular and title line.
I thought she then was going to say, I just want someone to the rescue me.
I feel like if she just said rescue, it still would work.
Oh, shit.
Nope.
But full title. You got to put the, you know, the. So then Julie, Ryan has to hide because Julie comes in and she sees... immediately hones on those flowers. Like, who are these gross, disgusting flowers? Like, I guess they're so...
They look like they're bought by poor people.
Hey, I guess they're such poor quality flowers, or obviously.
I wrote down tiny flower dick, so I guess that's how I felt about that's seeing your nickname the flowers. For
me. Yeah, let's remind you to ask Jamie something.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, tiny flower dick, get over here.
Okay. Hey, I'm tiny flower dick.
Did you get enough water today?
It's tiny flower Richard, okay? Tiny flower dick's my dad. Not be Mr. Tiny Flower Dick,
and he'd be Junior. But the exchange between Marissa and Julie there, I laughed. Where Julie goes, "You never told me." And she goes, "I tried, but." And Julie goes, "I need to talk to security." So specifically said, "You never listened to me," and then she interrupts her to leave.
Yeah, I guess it's like illustrating the point.
I mean, is there anything worth else?
Yeah. So, Julie, this is where Julie does blame all the bad stuff that's happened in Marissa's life on Ryan. Mm-hmm. And she goes through the, before Ryan got here, you would never not gone to your debutante ball. You would never gone to TJ and overdose. You had a boyfriend, all these type of things.
All the most important things.
And she says you were happy before he got here. And Marissa responds with, "You think I was happy?" I don't know if, I mean, I guess I'm asking you to interpret this without knowing what she's like before we saw her when Ryan got here, but was she happy? Why was she not happy beforehand? What is she saying? Do we get a sense of that she actually wasn't happy before Ryan got here? Why was she having problems?
No, she was listening to punk rock music. She didn't want to be, she didn't feel a part of the crowd, and she was constantly getting drunk and smoking cigarettes and not having fun. I mean,
but what we did see before Ryan got really in her head, I mean, she met Ryan one time, it's like she was really into him. He hadn't shaped her yet or changed her at all. I mean, that's when she was drinking excess and got dropped off on her front lawn. Like, she was trying to escape. I think you're right.
What are her hobbies? Does she do anything
over
for fun?
Drinking? I think we saw her steal shoplift at one point. So shoplifting,
standing at the end of her driveway,
drinking, staring off into the ocean,
thinking about stuff.
I'm gonna say she wasn't too happy with hobbies like those.
But also, it seems like she just overloaded herself with like school activities. Like, I know she's the head of the party planning committee. I think you learned that she's other things. She just throws herself in, not necessarily academically, though I think she's probably fine because I think all the kids in the OC are like geniuses and stuff. But I think she overloaded herself with responsibilities and all these things because I don't think she likes her life. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I guess Julie doesn't see that necessarily.
No, she is. If there's one thing we can take away from this episode is that Julie is not very attentive when it comes to noticing things about her daughter.
Does Julie want Marissa to grow up to be the next Kirsten?
Ooh, that makes sense. She kind of wishes she was Kirsten, I think. She wishes she was from the OC. She wishes she Jimmy loved her like he loves Kirsten. I mean, Julie's very aware of the fact that Jimmy settled for her because he knocked her up. And the last thing that happens to that scene really is that Ryan says he won't stay away no matter what Julie says. He says that to Marissa that, you know, I'm not scared if you're not. Like, I'm not going to stop seeing you.
You're not supposed to cause trouble, Ryan.
Yeah, come on. Just make it through. Graduate.
So we're also seeing Seth covering for Ryan's absence at home by saying that Ryan is on a diet.
That's my favorite way to cover a lie, because he goes, I'm on a diet. And she goes, why is he on a diet? He goes, why is he on a diet?
And that's all he needs to say.
Yep, you just re-ask the question and then lie is covered.
I did think that their mother-son relationship worked a lot better there. Like I was buying them as her kind of exasperated but kind of affectionate towards Seth and like, you're doing something, but I'm not going to like dig too deep into it. And we still have to talk about that Tijuana thing. Like I really bought their relationship for the first time in these first 8 episodes. So when Kirsten still goes to check on Ryan, even though the diet line doesn't work, he then says that he's studying naked.
Yes.
Which is important because of callback later.
And she still would do it if the doorbell hadn't rung.
And in walks Jimmy asking for legal advice. So well,
he won't walk in. He won't go in the house. And I thought that was an interesting thing of him.
Cannot keep himself from attacking sexually. Yes,
like a dog in the rain vampire. He won't get let in and just looks sad.
But he needs to come in because he needs to try to get Sandy's help through Kirsten to help him keep custody of his children.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And so, yeah, definitely his first line is something like, is Sandy at work still? That felt shady. And I was like, oh, yeah, this is going to get weird. But it was because I actually wanted to know where Sandy was and not make sure that he wasn't there.
Does Sandy not have a cell phone?
It's 2003. Cell phones were invented.
2003, and he's maybe some of the really gregarious younger people probably have them, but maybe in a like adult dude at work, maybe he didn't have a cell phone. I don't know. I didn't have a cell phone in 2003. Yeah, I got one when I went off to college. Yeah,
but I don't think it was the thing to like be at work and have one in your pocket. I don't feel like they were that ubiquitous yet.
Ooh, nice word.
Not that word.
You like that? You guys like that?
Ubiquitous. What does ubiquitous mean?
Ubiquitous. Which we're talking about how much time had passed between last episode.
14 years had passed,
and I hope that it wasn't more than a day or two that they still hadn't talked about Tijuana. I think that's just bad parenting.
It's Tijuana, Jamie. Yeah. God, you're so white.
God, that lie.
Pretty soon, we got Julie out of nowhere, 0-60 real fast, wanting to commit Marissa to an insane asylum.
Just wanting to get her out of Newport, though, because that's the easiest way to get her away from Ryan.
It seems like a crazy thing to do to be like, I didn't mean crazy in that way. But it's an intense move. Like, okay, I need to get her away from Ryan, I guess. So we need to get her out of the OC. So the move is to commit her. That just seems like a crazy. That's why I wrote 0-60 real. It's just like from there to there. Just we're going to commit her. Like, what?
And
that's crazy.
It's like what we talked about before, where the sentiment that she just tried to kill herself and almost succeeded. Something needs to be done. Meeting with a therapist, maybe even that involves going to rehab.
Well, so you're 100% sure that she tried to kill herself, right? I feel like we talked about last episode that we were all kind of on the fence thinking like, well, she's young. Maybe she doesn't really know what the combination of these pills and these drinks do. Mm-hmm. And she was just upset. So and Marissa protests this episode that she was not trying to kill herself. She was just trying to escape. And by escape, she means here, just like get drunk, stop thinking about it. And she just took whatever she had. I really don't think, personally, based on her actions and what I observe, I really don't think she was trying to kill herself from what I could tell.
And that's a fair point. And I don't think that I was so much driving that home. That I definitely concede that. That I don't think that she was actively trying to exit. I think she was being stupid and abusing pills and alcohol. Which, so I think all of that requires therapy and, once again, potentially even going rehab and getting out of the situation for a bit. But everything from there, I'm like, all right, I'll follow you that long. Then Julie goes off the cliff of logic.
It's also Julie's opinion on the whole thing, right? It's her viewpoint. In her viewpoint, it's she did try to kill herself because of Ryan causing problems. I don't think, does Julie ever explain exactly how Ryan did it other than just his influence has caused these things?
His appearance in their lives.
But it was never a specific thing like, Ryan, you did this because Ryan did what?
Yeah, it's not Marissa's best friend bought pain pills in Mexico and that's how she got there.
Or that they were getting a divorce and the dad's moving out and Luke's cheating on her.
Or that
those are specific things.
China had alopecia.
That's true. Her alpaca had moved to China. That's stupid.
Damn it.
Stupid joke.
Not like Captain Oates. Nothing can hurt Captain Oates.
Oh, Captain Oates is awesome. I'd rather you hate me than lose you is what Julie says to Marissa.
Because Julie maybe isn't all that bad.
Oh, she's you buy that sentiment. Yeah, I'd rather. So that makes sense when she says her thinking there. Like, yes, you might hate me because of this, but I'd rather you hate me than lose you to, another suicide attempt.
Lose the idea of what she wants Coop to be. She wants her to be Kirsten, but currently she's going of a different route.
Yeah, the disconnect between the fantasy and the reality, the romanticized version of what could be and what actually is.
Creepy or romanticized?
That's a good thing, because that's what is a big part of Madame Bovary that I'm going to go into. Hopefully it won't be too boring.
I like how often you're setting up this Madame Bovary bit.
You're hyping this shit, man. It's really going to be big.
Well, it's in the episode. Yeah, okay, so and then we get a second time this episode. I wish they had done this a little differently somehow, but Marissa, again, sneaks a call this time to Summer instead of Ryan. Mm-hmm. I feel like two sneaky calls from the hospital room. Is that really? Maybe you can come up with a different way.
Paper airplane on a note or something?
Yeah, I guess what else are you going to do, right? So then that's when we get in my favorite scene of this episode, which is Seth's room where Summer comes in. She's gotten the call from Marissa that Marissa needs help because her mother's going to try to commit her. So Summer comes to find Seth to get help from Ryan. So it's not, she doesn't need Seth, but it's weird. Cause okay, this scene for me, it feels like a big moment. Like I was excited and anxious for this scene to happen. Like, I don't know, like I'm shipping them, I guess, at this point. And I think she's cute. And I want him to get with her at this point, I guess, even though he's creepy. And it just felt like a big moment. Like she gets to see his bedroom for the first time. He's already seen hers, right? Mm-hmm. Or at least saw her in Marissa's bedroom. I don't know if he's seen.
Yeah, no, we haven't seen Summer's room.
Yeah. No, we haven't. But yeah, so this is her seeing his room. This is her being in his home space. She actually sought him out here instead of like, feels like before she didn't even consider him as a person that lives. But no, she's seeking him out. She's coming to his place. Okay. So I was like excited for this episode, for this moment. And so she knocks on the door. He thinks it's his mother's. And so his answer when she knocks is, "Not now, Mom. I'm studying naked," which is a callback earlier in the episode.
Loved it. And then we get the great Summer line of, "Ew."
And then, "What kind of family do you have, Cohen?" I think his answer is something like, "The kind that wears clothes all the time, even in the shower."
Just backpedaling hard. Also interesting to note that when Summer thinks he's naked in his room, her instinct is to cover her eyes, when earlier in episodes we saw that Seth makes sure that his eyes are not covered when he knows Summer is naked right in front of him.
He was craning around the corner to try to see her. So then she gets a glance at Captain Oates, which is his toy horse.
I love it. I feel like, I mean, we see lots of Captain Oates, right? He gets a spinoff show. Like, he'll show up a lot more.
It's a spinoff show?
That's, of course, 8 seasons.
Yeah, he comes back as a reference.
Which is a crazy thing. I guess it's just like, oh, he has a weird horse. Like, is the props put that in there earlier and then they're just referencing it?
It feels to me like a thing Josh Schwartz actually had from his past, maybe. Yeah. Or it's just a throwaway line from this episode that fans maybe latched onto. Like, what's up with Captain Oates? You know, fans are kind of ironic about what they like sometimes. Like, I like this stupid thing, and we're all going to pretend that this is our favorite thing in this episode.
You see a nice little shiny thing, and then... Yeah. Yeah.
So everyone, like, makes a fan page for Captain Oates. It's all ironic, but the people that run the show are just like, oh, they apparently identify with that horse that has no...
Give him his own cartoon.
I like Captain
Oates.
Either
of you heard the band Trapped, T-R-A-P-T?
No.
Seth had a poster up for them in his room. I didn't look up any of their songs because I didn't, but
no.
I was just wondering if you guys had heard them. Nope. Okay, that's
real,
enough.
I assume it's a real band.
They're real.
They sound like Hair Lab. They're pretty good.
Okay, so Summer needs Seth's help to find Ryan to save Marissa because he will stand up to Julie.
Yeah, I did like where she's like, "Why can't I just do it?" She says, "You're going to take on Julie Cooper?" And then he pauses.
We need Ryan.
Yeah.
As they walk out, he points to his bed and says, "That's my bed."
I just wanted you to know that. That's my bed.
Feels improv. What does he say at the end? Because he says, "That's my bed." She goes something like "gross" or something.
And then they mumble
before they go out the door.
All that I got out of it, but I wrote it down saying that I don't think I wrote this down right, where it sounded like he said something like, "Just wanted you to know that," okay, or something like that. But which is funny. It's a good line, but I might have missed exactly what he said there.
So they show up where Ryan is having his test to see if he can actually go to Harbor School with his new friends. And my question is, do they have to do this right now? I realize it's that Marissa is...
I don't know.
She's going to be committed, right? But like right now, during the only time today and maybe tomorrow, the next day, that he's actually engaged in doing something, it's very important for him to go to school. Like, has to go right. Can't wait an hour till he's done. Has to be right now.
I feel like they could have done a better job of establishing urgency for that. If for something like, "I'll call the people to take you to the crazy farm
give me a
right
ticking
now."
Clock,
like they're so driving here from San Diego to pick you up.
That's
right now.
What the ticking clock element in storytelling is for, so you know the stakes and know the tension, how high the tension is, and why it needs to happen right now.
Yes, because otherwise, every part of me is like, finish the fucking test. You're halfway, maybe even all the way done with it. Just take an extra 20 minutes, finish the test, and the whole thing of them busting in and being like, "Hey, Ryan, we're not allowed to come in while you're taking a test."
And he's the only one in there, which I guess that makes sense. He's the only transfer. And then the dean, it felt very artificial scene. Like, they come in, he's all there by himself, and then the dean comes up, hey, what's all going on in here? Just like a Scooby-Doo episode where,
the
like, someone
would
catches
not have
them
been
in the...
overseeing that. That would have been pawned off on some teacher.
It was strange to me, yeah. That whole thing was weird. But
although
anyway,
I'd be okay with all four of our heroes going to Newport Union and seeing how they
Oh, that would have been... They all get expelled this episode? Yeah. So they all...
That's a different show, though, right? Because the show is Ryan and come... from low back, not low, Ryan coming from a less affluent background, coming, moving on up. That's that this show, I guess.
It's guys, wasn't there a Friday Night Lights season where the character in the fancy school like had to start at a tiny, like a crappy school?
Yeah.
Luke Cafferty. Gee, I can't believe I remember his name. Yeah, Force. Luke Cafferty. Force Forever, Texas, whatever.
I'm never watching that show. Never watching it.
Texas, whatever, forever, Force. Texas, beer.
Force. Who's a better role model for Ryan? Sandy Cohen or...
Riggins?
Sandy Cohen.
I was going to say Coach Taylor.
My brother's dog. Coach Taylor. Oh, Coach Taylor is the best role model for everyone, always.
I just wanted to point that out.
They both have great hair.
They do. Okay, so after Ryan walks out, is there we get Marissa meeting with her therapist?
Yeah,
is there
Ryan
else
walks
you want to
out
talk
on
about?
The test. We got Marissa meeting with the therapist.
There was a thing I want to talk about where when she's going through all of the stuff that she's been in trouble for. She said specifically that she struggled with anorexia. Yeah. I know at one point you mentioned someone claiming that people thought Misha Barton was anorexic, and I didn't know if the show had been on long enough that this was like a callback to that.
I don't
that?
Know if this would be yet. There's a callback that happens in season, maybe the first episode of season two. I think at this point that wouldn't be calling.
Yeah.
They wouldn't be reacting yet.
But her saying it wasn't actually that at all.
Mm-hmm.
She was just
seemed
stressed.
Like a denial, if anyone.
Well, that's what my question is. Okay, not to get too... I mean, I don't know much about psychology, but I know that... but does it seem like all these lists of things that might be wrong with Marissa were told to the psychologist and therapist? I don't know what the difference is between those two. One prescribes meds, one talks to you. I don't
There's
know
which a group
one
of people therapy, that are furious right now.
Therapy is a part of psychology.
Okay.
Psychology also has other things in it, like neuroscience and different things. So a therapist is a psychologist, but all psychologists aren't therapists.
It's like a square rectangle situation.
Yeah, Roomba.
Okay. You're a square rectangle.
Okay, so thank you. So all these things that the therapist knows and lists off about Roomba. Marissa's problems, they've been told to her by Julie and given a frame of reference and context by Julie. Mm-hmm. So my question is, do you think that Marissa actually is troubled and these are things that are actually happening and Marissa just tries to explain them off like they're nothing, but they actually are? Or is Julie kind of have this weird Munchausen by proxy type of thing, but instead of making her daughter sick, she wants to think of her daughter as troubled? So, you know, Munchausen by proxy, want their daughter to be sick because it gives them attention and it makes them feel important. Does she want that same thing, but about being a troubled teen or something rather than being sick?
Is Munchausen, is the whole thing with Munchausen, you're actively injuring or hurting? Like you're
usually Munchausen is just yourself. Munchausen by proxy is usually like, usually it happens to be a mother and their daughter. And I think they'll add stuff. It's like in Sixth Sense, they'll add stuff to their soup to make them sick. But yes. I think they also, it could be more passive and they just enjoy the feeling they get.
Like the way a hypochondriac.
The hypochondriac. Yeah. They maybe push the daughter towards, you know, she's maybe pushing Marissa into thinking that she has these problems. For some reason, Julie likes the concept of having a troubled daughter and being important because of that, maybe. I was trying to figure out why she would interpret all of her daughter's issues to be like, you know, these teenage
that feels like
problems.
It's explained through her being very worried and scared right now and really grasping at any way that she can not lose her daughter. And so, I mean, I think those are all very honorable. Mm-hmm. And so it feels like her rap sheet that the therapist reads through feels like it was explained by an out of touch mom, like as a mom who doesn't actually know and never took the time to listen to Marissa's side of the story. So I don't know if I would necessarily say that she's somehow enjoying the drama of it, but that's just my take. I don't know.
She does like appearances, right? And so she probably don't want the appearance of Marissa not being perfect. So yeah, that would go against her.
It might even just be the panic at how much she dislikes this situation is why she would be acting.
Or she's just lying here, or she's just like over stressing these facts just to manipulate the situation. Like if she makes it seem like Marissa's worse than she is, that'll get her out of the OC, like Russell said.
There's a certain point with this episode where it almost feels like she just doesn't want to be wrong. Like, yes. There's a point where like she starts acting so crazy that the idea of like telling Jimmy that she's going to talk to Marissa and then like faking to get, I mean, I don't want to jump too much ahead, but like as if like, well, then once she goes there, she's just stuck there. Like it's prison or a different country that she's just going to be trapped there. Anyway, it was not logic that she was operating under, but it seemed very weird.
I just want to use the word Munchausen by proxy. Mm. So it sounds smart.
That's a bit ubiquitous at this point.
Yeah, very, very ubiquitous. Yeah, so Summer sneaks Seth and Ryan into the hospital using her candy striper outfit. Do candy stripers actually wear that shit? Is that a thing? I've heard the term candy striper.
From reading Pet Sematary, they claimed that they were called candy stripers because they were wearing all white, but they would always get splattered with blood.
Oh, yeah, I heard that too.
That's where that came. And I don't know. That also kind of feels like that might just be like a Snopes thing. But
I don't ever think that the candy striper outfit is that sexy. It's weird that they were like, ooh la la, just like Wolf Howl eyes bug out at her wearing a red and white striped dress. Like we've seen her in bikinis. Why is this all of a sudden? Aye, aye, aye.
Right. I feel like anytime a girl wears a uniform, people act like it's a thing. Like, ooh, a librarian. You mean a skirt and glasses? Like, I've never gotten that shit. I can get
sweater.
Like a cheerleader, I guess, just short skirt, right? In mid-dress. Uh-huh. I can get like bathing suits, but like, yeah, librarian, teacher, candy striper. It's just, you're just wearing clothes that have kind of a pattern based on, you know, a stewardess.
Yeah.
Granted, you call them flight attendants now, but like, it's just the fact that it's a uniform, I think, for some reason people are into.
And I mean, I guess, this is getting like a weird topic that I've never did, but in terms of like role playing and stuff, yep, that is probably like, mm-hmm, writing a story for them on some level. Okay.
A candy striper, how is that a sexy story? I guess you're a patient. Like, ooh, I can't move my legs.
Come wash my dick. Yeah. My dick is so dirty. It's been sitting in this hospital bed and it needs to be cleaned.
I'm going to think if... I don't know how into role-playing you are, but probably don't bring in the dirtiness of your penis.
Oh, God, I shit in the pan. Wipe my ass.
My dick is so dirty.
Lift your legs up so I can get to it, baby Russell.
Yeah, so ladies, if you want man to fuck you in role-play, DOC men probably aren't those.
No, we're talking about dirty dicks. Dirty dick Russell.
We got dirty dicks.
Okay. It seems like Seth was into the costume, right? And then Ryan didn't have that much reaction. It seems like Marissa made the biggest deal about the costume because Ryan comes into her in her hospital room and he gives her a
What? You said Ryan came into her. All right,
let's settle down. Guys. It was like Ryan. Keep it a little bit mature, okay?
Ryan is pee-pee shot white cream.
Vanilla cream. So he comes in and gives her a cane striper outfit as a costume for them to sneak out. And it seems like Marissa's... was reacting as if he'd given her full-on lingerie and thong and stuff. Like, oh, I bet this was Summer's idea. Like,
At first, I thought he'd just given her, like, the striper part. Like, this was essentially just the apron. And then I was like, that's why I thought that she was making such a big deal. That just like, hey, here's just the front of an outfit that you're going to have to wear. But nope, it was just a boring nurse's outfit.
Do you think it was creepy when she, like, took off her clothes to put it on and get like her back as she's in bed? I think it's supposed to be this like sexy moment. I was just kind of creeped out by the whole thing. I don't know why.
I felt super weird that Ryan wouldn't turn his ass around. Like he's just looking as if that's coy and playful.
She was kind of cool with it too. She's like, you're not supposed to look. So, I mean, they were doing a thing, but I just thought it was kind of creepy.
No, I feel like,
she's just in bed. She'd almost like OD'd because of her. I don't know. It just seemed like a creepy, just weird sexual moment that was just, the lines were crossed there for me.
And so, as far as I know, candy striper is pretty much like the lowest position. Like, right?
Just volunteers that come in and like, well, read books to the patients.
Yeah, like Madame Bovary.
Were there any candy stripers on Scrubs?
I don't know if it's such a thing anymore.
Okay.
But
are you jerking off that mug?
Yeah, mug.
But what I don't understand is how Summer putting on her candy striper outfit magically gives her security clearance to the entire hospital of just a... letting people around.
I guess it's that thing where they put on a doctor's coat in like action movies to get through the hospital. It just makes them not think about who is this person, why are they here. They give a little bit of a, oh, they're here because they're a candy striper, as opposed to looking at them as an individual. I mean, that's what uniforms do, right? It makes you attached to the part of the whole as opposed to individual.
So I guess it's a step closer. All right, I'll buy it.
Okay, now we're gonna get into Madame Bovary a little bit. I'm not gonna go too far. I'm not a scholar of Madame Bovary. I've read it, but I'm not.
I was disappointed to learn that this wasn't a book about a lady cow.
well, is there signification of the names of Madame Bovary?
Is it? Is she a cow?
Bovine's supposed to come in there. I don't know how that relates exactly.
How now?
But I know Flaubert is he's a realist, and every word means something. Everything is there as double. Everything is put there for a reason. So it's Bovine, Bovary. It's supposed to be a connection. But yeah, so Summer, we got that. Summer has Madame Bovary by Flaubert. It's in her push cart, her candy stripper push cart. She's read it five times, you've learned. And
Tom Shaw.
And Seth, for a patient of hers named Tom Shaw. And Seth is, again, a bit of a dick. Oh, a girl likes literature. She might, you know, because women can't be well read. He's dick about and a patron, you know, patronizing ass about that again. But he seems like he's at least impressed in a good way about it, but he shouldn't be impressed at all. She can fucking read. you know, so there's two things there. One, I think there's connection to the OC with Madame Bovary. And two, I thought it was a great moment for Summer. You got some more depth to her. This one little thing of saying, I've read it five times for Mr. Shaw, you've learned that she's okay. She doesn't just do candy striping as a fashion accessory or something. Like, she takes it seriously. She's come back enough times to read through entire book five times for this. You know, in theory, my head's a sweet old guy that's alone. She reads it to him. She worries about him when she brings up his name. She's like, oh, I should go check on him. I thought it was just a really good moment for her specifically.
She talks about it like, oh, I'm just doing charity, you know, whatever. It's not a big deal. But like, she actually gave a shit. And it's like the first real time where we're like, oh, wait, no, she's a pretty awesome person. She's a cool dude.
Yeah. So what more, what else is there about Summer that is like that she's fronting as dumber than she is or more shallow than she is?
Absolutely.
I think it speaks to that. And just to go through Madame Bovary, if you're not familiar.
I'm not.
Madame Bovary is essentially, it's a story of Charles Bovary, who is kind of like a dorky Seth as a young man, kind of awkward. He marries Emma Bovary, or her name's Emma when he marries her, and she's kind of becomes a focus. She not super great at being
faithful.
Being faithful to her husband, Charles, because he's a bit of a rube, a little bit of a boring guy. Doesn't come from a lot of money. Kind of a backward. And she,
not a good excuse.
So everyone she falls in love with, she eventually grows bored with, and she borrows a bunch of money and steals and stuff to get them presents. And then she grows bored and pushes them away by being overly clingy or over demanding. And it's just this constant cycle. It's what I've heard referred to as femininity as vampirism almost. This young woman like sucking the life out of these men.
Is she supposed to be a likable protagonist?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
So eventually ends with Emma Bovary after
her
life being so put to ruins by her own lack of being able to accept her reality as what it actually is rather than what she thinks it should be. She is turned down by one of her lovers, and she kills herself by taking arsenic. In her head, this romantic, beautiful act of dying by your own hand, but in actuality, it lasts for hours and hours and is full of agony. So that's kind of Madame Bovary, and I connected to the OC in a couple ways. One being, there's these themes present that I see in both this episode and the OC when you're talking about Marissa, which is the lack of agency by women except through the men they date, or the lack of ability to find themselves except for the men that they situate themselves against. The way Marissa has to have a Luke or has to have Ryan. She can't just by herself. She has to call Ryan for help. Yeah, everyone, all these women are defined by they're men in some ways. I would say not 100%, but I see this connection. One being the mediocrity of the bourgeois class. You've got, I think you see this most in Sandy's new job, where they're talking about just the boring vapidness that is being a lawyer representing this higher society, this nicer class. And we also got Emma in Madame Bovary always looking out windows. It's a common repeated theme. It's her thinking about something outside, not accepting the reality she lives in, but always looking forward. This idealization, what's outside must be better. And we see this a lot with
Ryan in the opening credits.
Oh, yeah, Ryan in the opening credits, certainly. And then in my opinion, I don't think you see so much of it yet, but Marissa loves to stare out at the ocean. You see her a little bit staring out at the end of maybe the debutante ball episode or something. But
is the ocean in front of their driveway?
That too, she's staring at the end. But yeah, later on, she finds a lifeguard station, just constantly just sits there for hours and stares at the ocean, which is, I think, reminiscent
of
that.
Sounds like a great episode.
Also,
real time.
That's usually her in the off screen, and they're like, where's Marissa. And like, oh, she's
staring
there.
At the ocean.
All right, let's go have fun.
Also in Madame Bovary, there's this contrast between the romanticized life and the real life, like I'm talking about here. It's kind of a result of this being a work of Madame Bovary being a work of realism as a style. And we see that a little bit in the contrast between the romanticized life and real life of Marissa, what she expects her life to be, what it actually is turning out to be, things like that.
Wikipedia told me that Madame Bovary was about Emma being bored with her husband and that life, and then having a bunch of affairs in order to feel happy and fulfilled. And in my mind, that, especially because it was Summer reading it, made me feel like Summer was bored with her normal OC life and was using her relationship with Marissa and Seth and Ryan as a sort of escape from that in order to like have fun and like feel alive. So like those are her affairs in order to get away from her boring regular OC life.
Oh, that's perfect. Yeah. I mean, you can look at it that way too.
That's an interesting, because we know that Summer clearly loves it. Well, at least has read the book a lot.
So yeah, five times. Yeah.
That's interesting to look at her as a character who, for better or worse, is basing a lot of her life choices, because we certainly see that at least the shallow version we've been introduced to her as, like, that's how she's sort of trying to project her life. So knowing that she loves Madame Bovary certainly could tell a lot about who she is.
I'm making these connections to Marissa, but I think it's specifically Emma here is we're seeing that Summer's exterior is not what her interior is. Her she's projecting a version of herself when she wants to be a different way. She wants to actually be able to hang out with Ryan, Seth, and be closer to Seth. But when the cheerleaders walk by, she has to put on this face again. The last thing I'll say
about her interior and exterior. Let's get on to that posterior.
That's true. The last thing I'll say is is obviously the connection between Madame Bovary does, you know, kill herself after being rejected by a man, and then obviously Marissa attempts to in some ways after being rejected by Luke in a way. Not rejected, but being cheated on. And then there's also a connection in this specific episode, a big contrast, a big part of Madame Bovary's is contrast between like a rural wedding and the marquee's ball. So they have this rural wedding between Emma and Charles, and there's a marquee ball that show how much better it is. And we see this contrast between like the bourgeois and the more common man. And we see this constantly in this episode. We've got Ryan's old school compared to the contrast of his new school. We've got Sandy's old job compared to the contrast of his new job. Mm-hmm. I feel like this is going through these same type of thematic elements, I think, which is interesting. That'll wrap up my Madame Bovary talk, but since I knew a little bit about it, I want to get something out there, just like, something I can kind of talk about.
Sure.
Did Flabbery write anything else?
Flaubert, I'm sure he wrote other. I know this was his introductory work. This is his first big published piece. I'm sure he went on to write more, but I feel like this is what he's known for.
Changed his name to John Grisham.
He also started up this like woman as vampirism, this kind of like woman leading the man astray, almost like he'd be fine if she did not like suck the life force out of him. You get that with
which Ryan would be fine if Vampire Marissa would just fucking leave him alone.
She's not a vampire anymore.
Get that with the book Daisy Miller.
Oh, she's not a vampire anymore.
Yeah, we were saying virgin as vampire.
Oh, right. Yeah. There we go.
She's no longer a vampire.
That's a callback. I completely to like three episodes ago.
Ignored why we called her a vampire, and in just my mind, she's a vampire. She's a vampire. Let me relate this show to Buffy.
Though it makes me want to connect it now because they shove Bovary in here, which is woman is vampire in a way. So I want to see more ways that Marissa is, I guess.
I think it means Melissa Rosenberg sees herself as Madame Bovary.
Okay. Well, you know, like we're talking about, Marissa seems to like suck the life. Rosenberg. I don't know.
She did the teleplay of the episode.
There you go.
Got it.
I should always check those out. But if we go with me, Marissa sucking, not the life force, but like, you know, finding the weaker male because she wants to help them out. Maybe you can see some sort of vampirism there, but it seems like she tries to help those
people.
Like
a reverse vampire.
She's a reverse vampire.
She can only go out during the day.
Damn it. I was gonna...
No, it's a mummy, idiots.
Irrevap?
Mabezel.
Irrev? No, I can't do... How do you say vampire backwards? Ira...
Rye.
Irrevmav. Irrevmav. Irrevmav.
All right.
Let's maybe move on from that.
Now, how do we say other things backwards? S-01E08-CO.
Anyway, Luke shows up to help them escape with Marissa. In a bro move.
So
Luke,
cool.
Luke shows up with flowers. He seems reticent.
Total
reticent,
Luke.
Is that the word?
Is it time for Luke watch?
Ubiquitous.
He feels ubiquitous, and he wants... time for Luke watch. So Luke's showing up to help them escape and feeling bad about what happened.
Luke.
And it was such a worry. It was like, what's he going to do? Is he going to be a Duke?
No.
Or is he going to be lukewarm?
Luke. He's a total Luke, but why was he only in this one scene? Why wasn't he in more scenes? Come on, Luke, be in more scenes.
Couldn't have showed up at the intervention talking to Julie.
Bad news, guys. This is the last episode he shows up.
Shut the fuck up.
No way.
That's some fucking bullshit if that's true.
No, it's not true.
Fuck you.
I just want a reaction. I just want a false reaction. I just want to see if you guys would care if he never showed up again.
I will leave this podcast so fast.
Okay, so they escape out like the back stairs. They're trying to... I don't know. What is their plan at this point exactly?
Go to Jimmy's.
And so they... before they show... is that their ending plan? Just like if we talk to Jimmy, he'll solve? Is that what they're thinking, I guess?
No, I think they're thinking we just got to get her away so that she doesn't get committed so we have time to think about what's going on.
And in that case, they are, you know, they're successful. She does not get committed. She, you know, can get away from the hospital before it happens. And
And she definitely certainly interacts with her father better than she does with her mother. You know, that
he seems more down for logic, I guess. Julie seems to be more ruled by emotion.
DTL.
We have a quick scene with Kirsten surprising Sandy as he's having after work drinks with Rachel.
That was she has so weird.
Jimmy in tow for advice.
Every character acted so weird in that scene.
Jimmy really weird, by the way. Like, I'll just leave. No, stop calling attention. If I'm standing, I'm like, Jimmy, stop fucking calling. Just stay here and ask your question. Don't be like, oh no, I'll leave you guys. You're obviously so fucking weird. This girl.
I want this to blow up so that you and I can have a chance.
Oh, that's true. Jimmy's sabotaging.
And I'm Rachel. I'm Rachel.
And I'm Courtney Cox.
That was my interpretation of that scene. Is like Rachel saying.
Rachel did not know what was happening there, in my opinion. She was just like, hey, nice to meet you. Because I really think she has no intention with Sandy. She's just good friends. They're kind of flirty friends. But some of your friends you flirt with, like me and Russell. So I think she was seriously just doing this kind of like, oh, I didn't know why would there be a problem? We're just good friends and we're just hanging out.
It's my job to bring good lawyers on. And I knew a solid lawyer and I brought him on. I'm doing good.
I still don't 100% understand why she did bring him on, because it feels like she gets very frustrated. We've been skipping over those scenes.
He's an idealist, right?
And we're very impressed with how good you are at being a lawyer. We want you to come on board. Then spends the whole day ragging him about...
Do everything different.
I guess while they have to go to trial so few and far between, there will be times where they will go to trials. And when they do that, they need the best that they can get. And Sam is the best they can get. So it's just unfortunate that he can't do anything in between. But they want the best for those trials.
Got it. So he's... a switch hitter.
And it seems like she's also just friendly. I think she just likes him. They're friendly, you know? They like each other, so...
Don't sports teams have, like, special people that they, like, bring out only in weird situations?
I don't think they call them switch hitters. I'm fairly certain switch hitter is something else entirely.
Switch hitter means you can bat on either side, but I thought it was like, so if you had suddenly had a left-handed pitcher, then you call in this one guy, and he's like, it's the guy who can bat the other.
I would say he's a closer.
Okay.
You would probably have the switch hitter be in the permanent lineup because they can change no matter what. You'd bring in, say, a lefty or a righty specialist, like a guy that cannot hit left-handed pitchers at all. But if you put in a right-handed pitcher, he will definitely hit that
right-handed pitcher.
Make sure you check out the Columbia Fireflies this summer.
Fireflies. It should be the Lightning Bugs, by the way, because of Louis the Lightning Bug. It should definitely be the Columbia
Lightning
Bugs.
Who is Louis the Lightning Bug?
Neither of you guys know who Louis the Lightning Bug is?
No.
It was a... Maybe you were in Charleston when you were very young, right? And you were in Pittsburgh.
That doesn't make a difference. Who the fuck is
SCNG? Used to be stay away from those power lines. It was like this mascot for the power company in Columbia.
Was that a problem?
SCNG is all South Carolina, though, so I should be familiar.
Yeah, that's true.
Were people in South Carolina running into power lines?
It was a mascot for the power company to tell children not to play near power lines. Because we're dumb down here in Columbia, and we love to just play on them like they're monkey bars.
Oh, they're
just
a blast.
They buzz sounds so good.
City. Buzz, buzz.
So yeah, that whole scene, I didn't get why Jimmy left. I didn't get why Sandy and Kirsten were just mad at each other.
Were they flirting? Is Kirsten right to be jealous?
No, they haven't done anything. And no one has made their intentions known. And
talking about them flirting. We've saying they've been flirting, but flirting ain't cheating.
They just have chemistry.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like either of them have kissed and not told Kiki.
That's true. That's the thing. She doesn't have to stand on it all, in my opinion, Jimmy kissed her and she's still hanging out with him.
Right.
And she's like, I think when Sandy brings up like, hey, I trust you, even though you've been hanging out with Jimmy all the time.
Perfect opportunity to come clean.
Yeah.
Yep.
She's actually did. That's what, you know. But yeah, so it seems like she backs off when he reminds her of that, basically.
Oh, yeah. I'm not holier than thou.
There's a great argument moment when they're arguing about the same issue. And she brings up how young the girl is and the woman is. And Sandy brings up, oh, she graduated Berkeley just 4 years after you. And then Kiki counters with like, oh, yeah, what's your favorite color? And then Sandy goes, pink. Anything else you want to know? It's just a great, like, I thought it was a great fight. It just read really well. Mm-hmm. And it made, I got why they both said the things they did. And they both made their points. It was cool. Okay, so let's go back to the Scooby gang. They run to Marissa's dad's apartment. And they're all...
Do you feel like Jimmy was a narc, like just immediately calling, or do you feel like that was the right thing to do?
That's the right thing to do. Well, she's trying to take him away. Yeah, if he lied then, that would be grounds that he would lose everything.
Yeah, she's threatening to take custody. He doesn't want to be hiding her without telling, you know, that's not good.
I was trying to decide if that was like the spineful move or just the spineless move. I feel like he's prone to doing spineless moves, but... Yeah,
I think it was irresponsible. I don't know if it's spineful. Mm-hmm. I think it was responsible. It's what you need to do. It's what a grown-up does in that situation.
I looked at the spine as half full.
Okay.
The spinal fluid is half full.
You're an optimist about it, huh?
Yeah, so when they show up at his house, by the way, when Jimmy walks in, they're all waiting on his couch. I got a very childlike vibe of all of them.
Were they sitting in the dark?
They're sitting like in a like a small spill of light or the dark on these couches. And it felt like earlier in the episode, you know, they're making decisions. They're breaking out of... they're breaking out of the hospital, you know, they're going to TJ, they're drinking, but this episode, when they need help, they come to a parent's house and they just sit on the couches like kids. I thought that was an interesting thing to do.
That's something we've certainly seen in other episodes. With Ryan. With Model Home, where it's like they're playing at being adults, and then there's scenes that drive home the fact that they are not adults. Mm-hmm. They're still just kids.
Which I think is a smart move, otherwise it gets a little bit too ridiculous. Like, where are these kids' parents? Why they all act like adults?
I like the joke of when they were thinking of where to go, Seth suggests we could hide Marissa in one of his mother's developments. I thought that was... We're talking about callbacks and fun lines. Seth had a lot of them this episode.
I thought it was bullshitting of his friend's laugh when he said that. They all just came look like, how could you say that? Like, it's obviously a joke, guys.
Was it too soon? Come on.
It's not like it's your model house. And it's only the first, you know, only second floor.
Yeah.
So he narks, Jimmy narks on them to Julie, and they all run away.
And then Ryan narks on them to Sandy.
And then Sandy arbitrates sit down.
Between, he brings a tree?
He arbitrates a sit down between Julie and Ryan, which is a callback. I think this is great. It's Sandy kind of hangs a lantern on it, but it's just kind of like you don't get to... he's learning that he needs to arbitrate his new job. He needs to settle. And that's the callback that they do here, that they actually they have someone arbitrate between the two sides. They settle an argument between Ryan and Julie.
And I loved the fact that that was a callback. Everything about the setup of that scene was great. I felt a little bit like the actual scene didn't play out as well as I wanted it to. Like, it felt like that could have played out as an actual arbitration. Instead, it kind of felt like Seth just kind of, or not Seth, but Ryan just sort of attacks Julie a lot, and there's not a lot of like back and forth. It felt like
he didn't do a good, like, his part of that. I think Sandy probably had to talk with him like, this is how you should act, and Ryan just like attacked him.
Ryan goes, if you ever want to see your daughter again, man, like, what the hell fuck was that? Like, way to just escalate the problem.
And I liked how Sandy was like, that's enough of that. Like, Sandy like held him like accountable like a father or something.
But it felt like I don't know, maybe the future of the show is that Julie needs to be set up as the villain, but it felt like that would have been a great opportunity for her to sit down, them to sit down, both people who've been feeling heightened emotions and not thinking correctly and not talking through things. It's like, okay, Julie, tell us how you're feeling. This is how this is going on, how an arbitration should work. Sure. But
making allowances to give and take.
And so I was like, oh, what are they going to have to sacrifice to come to a compromise and reach the end of this? But no, it's just everyone gangs up on Julie.
We won't have anal for 3 months.
Oh, that was outside of the podcast.
Julie's like,
right?
No, it must be 2 months. Okay. Ryan tries to level with her about being from Riverside because he knows what it's like because he's from Chino. She does not like that.
No.
That is not the good move.
She starts backing out the door at that point.
Yeah.
She wasn't happy when Sandy brought it up. Why would she be happy when Ryan brings it up?
Almost scared. I think that's where they get the, at that moment that you realize that she really is just scared for Marissa. That's where she kind of says it. She's acting this way because she actually says what you've been kind of observing, that she's just scared for Marissa here.
She knows how bad Riverside is. Yeah. She doesn't want that for her daughter.
She don't want her to go there. That's where she's from.
I do want Ryan and Julie to knife fight at some point, though.
Okay.
I'd say that's fair.
Chino rules.
That's how they solve all their problems.
And it seems like the argument's working a little bit, especially when Marissa shows up from behind Julie and she says, I want to live with Dad. And it seems like Julie's gotten the point, but then she kind of leaves with this ominous,
you haven't heard the last of me.
This isn't over, Marissa.
Yeah.
And I guess she's just leaving. She cares so much that she's going to leave her with these people that she doesn't trust.
Right.
All this is over her wanting to protect Marissa and that Ryan's a bad influence. So she's like, whatever, Marissa, and just leaves her at Ryan's house. That's her, I thought that was a strange move on her. But it seems like she'd be like, yeah, not that you haven't heard the last of this, but you're coming with me now and drags her home or something. It's weird to just leave her there, in my opinion.
Now you're...
Oh, go ahead.
No.
We're getting a lot of scenes of the Coens and the Coopers intermingling, but there's lots of points, and this is another one of those scenes where I just was very conscious of the other family watching that didn't need to be there. It felt like the whole thing of her being like, I want to live with Dad, feels like a shitty thing to just yell in front of everybody. That could have been like, let's step aside and have this. I don't know why.
Well, why did Sandy need to arbitrate between Ryan and Julie? Shouldn't he have arbitrated between Marissa and Julie?
I guess allows Ryan to look like a bit of a knight.
Well, I guess part of the arbitration had to do with trying to get her to level with Ryan and be on Ryan's side, because the argument is that she does not trust Ryan and doesn't want Ryan to be around her. Julie doesn't want that. So they need to arbitrate on behalf of Ryan because she needs to kind of accept him as something that's going to be in Marissa's life.
Yeah.
Because that is the sticking point, right?
Which I like that, and I wish there would have been a dialogue there, but maybe if it was a movie, that would have been a great final scene of the movie where they find common ground and decide to live happily ever after, but we've got 3 more seasons to get through.
So this isn't over, Marissa. What does that mean exactly? Like, I'm still going to try to commit you next episode, or you win this round, but we're still going to be angry at each other? Like, what does that mean to you guys?
It does seem weird because it implies that there's a conflict between the two of them. And really, it was just like, all Marissa was saying is that you're not listening, and I realize that you're scared, but you're not listening. And so the idea of like, this isn't over, feels like that's not how you end that conversation. But maybe she doesn't want to lose custody.
Is it like, this argument is not done, young lady? Was it one of those type of things? Or is it like, this isn't over, Batman? Like, what was the tone of that?
I feel like the first one.
Okay.
But I got the vibe of the second one a little bit.
I did. I got the vibe of the second one. Do we think that committing her is off the table now, though? Like, she's gotten over that. There's still going to be, you're still not going to hang out with Ryan, maybe, but we're not committing you anymore?
Yeah, committing no more, but she's still going to try and get Ryan out of her life.
Fair enough. Yeah. I don't want your laugh. Not Friday Night Lights.
That's a football thing I can get behind.
Okay, so then we're coming to a close pretty quickly here.
Seth and Summer are having a breakfast club moment out the pool.
That was awesome. I like the chemistry.
I think she's kind of adorably mean to him there again. I don't know why I wrote that. Why was she adorably mean to him? What'd she do there?
He was like, bye, Summer. And she was just turned around and smiled or something. He was like, are we still going to be friends or something?
After all that's happened, are you still not going to be able to say hi to me when you run into each other in the hallways of school? And she said something like, all I can do is try or something like that.
Yeah.
Just kind of cute and flirty. It was flirty. Like,
they are the definition of flirt.
And if you noticed, earlier on, they had a scene with just the two of them. The cheerleaders walk by, and Summer kind of gets up and walks away, and she seems like almost sad. This time, he says bye, Summer, and she walks away, and she kind of like pauses and then gives him kind of like a cute look over her shoulder.
Yep.
Which I thought was, it seems like is mirroring that scene earlier, but with a different ending to it, almost like a more hopeful. She's more playful, and she's not, you know, she looked over her shoulder. And
I think, I didn't understand. I thought you did a good job of explaining when they kissed at the two episodes ago.
No tongue.
No tongue. That it's making baby steps towards a really, it's not like, not, they'll be making baby steps later. There's not.
What does that mean?
Fucking.
Oh. Yeah. Making baby steps. I should have known that.
You're right. But no, the idea that it's not going to wrap up perfectly. She's not going to be 100% into him. But it's that smile over her shoulder is saying, we're making progress.
It's
one step closer. Yeah.
And you actually saw in this episode the earlier version of it than the later version, as opposed to like trying to remember it from two episodes ago.
There's been progress.
Okay. So Mom also has Mom Kirsten has a bit of a reaction to hearing Summer's name. So my question is, has she like washed Seth's stiff socks with Summer written on them before? Like, does she know that Summer is as creepy of...
Once again, you mean your boat?
Like, this crazy obsession of, yeah.
Well, he's talked about going to his papa's
going to the
birthday party with Summer. Okay. So she should be aware of her.
Okay. It feels like a small enough community that probably... We didn't meet... Summer's mom wasn't one of the people who went on that retreat with... Okay.
What retreat are we talking about? I don't know.
When they had the spa weekend for Julie, because it was her last weekend to be able to do anything ever with the noobs.
The lobster episode.
Samurais.
Lobster Samurais.
Dynasty Warriors.
Maybe.
All of this is callback.
All we know at this point is that Summer's mom is pretty much comatose at all points. Her stepmomster is pretty much comatose at all points because she zonked herself out of
She didn't have a coke problem in college or hire a Puerto Rican family to clean her house.
It's possible. Yeah, she says, it's kind of the ending gag is Kirsten saying to Seth, now let's talk about that surprise ship to Tijuana. And his Seth's reaction, while I was pronouncing it that way all last episode, it's pronounced Tijuana. God, you're so white, Mom. It's a funny that's line, awesome. But that's also why I kept pronouncing Tijuana that
Mom's
way.
So white.
Seth can never be disciplined.
He'll never listen. Is this about the carpet?
Or the drapes.
And then we get the scene with Sandy and Ryan, which was awesome. That was
Except for awesome. The, you're going to miss me when I'm... never mind.
He says that to Seth, but yeah.
That's the later scene.
He basically holds him to task, something like, you know, you went and helped Marissa and I get that, but you know, if you just go back, explain your situation, you can take the test again, you can do it, just persevere, don't just take it as a loss, don't just accept defeat. Sandy giving Ryan this advice, and the next scene kind of teleports pretty fast to him coming out of the test, and he's passed it like Sandy knew he would.
Yeah, I think Sandy's saying, you know, I got your back, and then he actually showed up. Like, goddamn, he's an awesome father figure.
Yeah, and we get a nice moment like with Seth and Sandy have a slap fight outside. That's very amusing to me. And Russell was bringing up
Sandy had that line about you're going to miss me when I'm gone, which I hope is not foreshadowing of any sort because that is weird. It's a creepy downer thing to say. It's like something someone says right before they die.
Yeah. It's a weird thing to bring up there. But he also said, Dad, those eyebrows are out of control. Yes. I think that's what he responded to.
Yeah, that was awesome.
I feel like that's commenting on...
Definitely, because that's what everyone says about Peter Gallagher. Yeah. He's got giant eyebrows, but I like that he gets to say they're a sign of power.
And they're genetic. Get ready for them, son.
And you must be the most powerful man in the world.
Then they have this, like, it felt like an end of the season shot or something. This, like, zoom out as you see the whole campus of the college of the high school.
Do you guys think there's a comedy newspaper at the harbor called the National Lagoon?
Damn it. Yes. No, I don't think
that. Okay, I know for a fact that Seth is the editor of that.
Oh.
So that's the end of the episode. We got any questions?
Promises.
We already talked about this a little bit, but Luke Watch, give me a number 1 through 10. Is he lukewarm or is he Duke?
He'd be 10. He'd be completely Luke if he was actually in the episode, but he's not in the episode, really.
But what you saw of him.
No, what I saw of him, he was a complete bro.
Yeah. Do we think Luke's going to hold out here now? Have we seen the end of Duke at this point? Has this been this inciting incident that has shown him a mirror, had him hold up a mirror to himself, or are we going to get Duke as a villain again?
No. He's completely Luke between the assassination attempt and watching the lady of his life attempt to kill herself.
Mm-hmm. If I've learned anything, it's that Luke is the most inconsistent character ever, and so I fully expect that once we're in school that he'll shove Ryan into a locker.
What would be your ideal future for their relationship with Luke? If you could pick one, what would it
whose
be?
Relationship with Luke?
Just the main characters, Ryan and Seth.
If you
could write Luke from now on.
No, okay, perfect. Because I just watched that. Listen to How Did This Get Made? You guys have seen Bloodsport, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I want Luke to be the big bearded buddy.
Ogre.
Yes, who starts off as a villain, then he beats him up in a bar, and then beats him at video games, and then instantly becomes his best friend. So he just has this like super big dude who just follows him completely. So I want Ryan to be Van Damme and Luke to be Ogre.
So anytime they get into trouble, the big man on campus will be there to help them out if they need it.
Right.
Yeah.
They're giant, as it were.
Exactly.
Isn't that movie My Giant?
Little Giants. Yeah.
Where it's got Adam Baldwin from Firefly as the little kid's protector that follows him around.
I forget the other guy.
Which is kind of like Ryan and Seth to begin with a little bit.
It's like a Rick Moranis type. But
I think Josh Schwartz mentioned the My Giant as like one of his inspirations, by the
way. That would be a weird sort of like a lineage of protectors where you have like Seth being protected by Ryan, who then in my ideal world would be protected by Luke. And then
who's then protected by Summer, because I wouldn't fuck with Summer. I feel like she'd kill you.
Oh, he's just stabbed a dude with forks, a fork.
And shit. Yeah. Blackout rages.
Luke did save Ryan from a burning house, so exactly. He kind of already is his protector.
That's true.
So that's what that's what's going to happen, right?
Oh, I can't wait for Ryan to accidentally get sent back into juvie by Julie, and then Luke decides to commit a crime so
Daredevil
he can go
style.
Back to juvie with him so that he can protect him there.
Yeah.
Daredevil,
one of them
y'all.
Has to get a tattoo of the map on their back. I didn't watch Prison Break either.
And then get made fun of on Twitter. So where's Seth and Summer? That guy was made. He put on a little weight, and everybody knew shit because they're fucking assholes.
Yeah,
he looked fine. He looked perfectly fine.
He looked happy.
He looked like he's having a good time. So where are Seth and Summer? Where are Ryan and Marissa at the end of this episode as couples?
We got the Seth and Summer sort of establishing right at the end where they're inching closer to being a couple.
The D.
Inching closer to that D.
Who will have sex first then? Seth and Summer or Marissa and Ryan? I think Seth and Summer would have sex first. Before.
We have one virgin at least in that equation that we know of, and we have no virgins in the equation.
I bet Ryan's a virgin.
Ryan's a virgin?
I don't know.
Wait, has it been established that which couple has no virgins? Virgins.
Ryan, Marissa, probably.
So we know that Ryan fucked?
I would assume he has.
Fuck what?
That dude fucks. Yeah. I mean, I think if one thing can be said about Ryan is that dude fucks.
He and Donnie went out on dates with dancers.
But I thought Seth was getting down with the dancers.
Seth was making some headway with that dancer.
Seth was talking to someone at the party who was just being patient with him.
That's a fair point. He was just talking to a female person. All right. Well, if you could consider
talking to ladies at parties, hooking up with them, well then
I wasn't necessarily
I'm no longer a virgin.
I wasn't necessarily talking about sex. I was just saying where their relationships are.
Yeah.
Which one's going to fuck the other one first, but
you can't.
I was saying they were inching closer to a relationship. Yes, okay. You guys made it dirty.
Fair enough.
I think eventually
the D, that's right.
Yes. Eventually Summer is going to accept one of Confidence Cohen's proposals for a date, but it's going to be right as Anna returns, I imagine, which is going to be a big old bummer.
And then Ryan, Marissa. Seems like Marissa's down, like has no awkward issues. Like she's all Ryan now.
Yeah. It seems, well, the way this episode ends, we've removed both Luke and Julie from the equation, which were the only two roadblocks standing in their way. No. The Coens seem to be very supportive of him boning down with the next door neighbor. And so if the end of this episode were to be believed, they're going to be happily married by next episode.
All right. We talked about this as we go on, but thoughts on female characters? Is this question still necessary? Are they given enough agency, enough roles? I can stop asking the question.
I mean, I think we definitely bovaried this episode. So, I mean, we talked lots about the ladies.
Okay. What new storylines, problems, or promises do we see arising?
School's the big one. Mm-hmm. That sort of shifted the focus from just being summer break.
Are you guys excited for the school, or is it kind of like, this teenage bullshit? I don't want to see school or school.
I want to see Ryan go out for the water polo team. That's what I want to see.
Okay.
I guess a horse finally. and I think that's been a big one. I think the shift of the dynamic between Marissa and Ryan, which seems to be one of the big points of drama, has shifted a bunch. The rest of the family, though, rest of the Coens, well, I guess Sandy, we got his new job, which we will still continue not to talk about.
Do you care about his new job at all? I mean, this show is supposed to be as much about the parents and their lives as the kids and their lives, but do you care? We don't seem to recap those that much. Do we care about Sandy's job?
I want to see how money changes him, or if it changes him, because now he's going to be actually making money, and what does that mean for him?
Yeah, I think I like Sandy as a character so much, and I like Kirsten as well.
Kiki.
Their stories, though, are always just sort of like, oh, we'll just take a break from the main drama. So I like that they're part of the show, but I don't necessarily get excited about them or find as much meaning there. So I'll be interested to see where they go at least.
Cool, cool. So what's your thinking of this? I haven't done this before. What's your thinking of this episode? It's number 8 out of the 7 we've watched. How's it ranking? What do you think of this episode?
I feel like it ranks pretty high up there. You got to remember that it's attached to the episode before, which I feel like The Escape is like probably the best episode that we've seen yet. And so it's dealing with the ramifications of that episode. And so it is obviously higher up there. I feel like it as an episode has a lot to say, which is why we saw it used for informational purposes only. And I feel like that separates it apart from just a show about dumb teenagers doing dumb things, which is what I imagine other teenager shows are like. And so it's pretty solid in that aspect.
I think last episode definitely felt like they're spending a lot of budget, you know, going new locations. It was shot really cinematically. And this one felt a little bit of, return to form. But I like, I think all of the characters have progressed to a point where I'm more excited to watch stories about them than I have been in previous ones. I will say there were some key points that were drama causing things that felt a little forced, so maybe I wouldn't rank it as my favorite, but I still enjoyed myself a lot.
What would be a key point that was drama enforcing behavior?
One would be like the conversations, the with the Kirsten and Sandy story would be that conversation there.
Where push that into conflict where maybe you just give Sandy the benefit of the doubt. That's, or was that her reacting because she was feeling guilty about her own thing with Jimmy?
It was like stuff that I get where it was going, but it felt forced and like it could have been a little better.
Why do you hate the OC, Jamie?
Listen, you guys, I think this is my last episode. I think I'm done.
What? Will Jamie return next episode?
I'll be on 902.
On The Walking Dead. Who just got hit by a bat?
I haven't
watched that.
It's Jamie.
No, my new podcast is 9021 Joe's. I don't think that's the theme song. How about you, Will? How do you feel like looking at these 8 episodes? Like, how does this rank?
I think it's the first episode we've gotten without like a party frame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's arguable that maybe like the Tijuana episode.
So white.
The escape that there wasn't, but there was a party in TJ. So I think it's the first one that we don't have that. And this is definitely that first of many, if not, maybe not the first, but early trip to the hospital. We get that a lot in the OC. We get a lot of this like fallout from like something happened where someone's injured and we're sitting bedside. We get the start of that whole trope that's in the OC.
Sure.
I feel like we're getting the ensemble cast together, really. Mm-hmm. We got a little bit in the escape. We're getting it more in the rescue. They're breaking out of hospitals. They're hanging out. They're sneaking around the Fab Four, the Core Four. So I like seeing that being more and more prevalent. I think there's still some. Usually the OC will have those four. Then they'll be surrounded by kind of secondaries that come in and out. They're kind of like the outer circle, not the inner circle of the group. And I feel like we're still yet to get some of those. We got a little bit of Luke there, I guess, but we get more of those later. I think I always enjoy the short time that they're there with the group.
They're there.
So it's getting there. It's getting to a nice, comfortable level of this is what I want to see on my OC.
Yeah. And so that's interesting to know. If someone who's seen more of them, it feels like we're getting closer to the status quo type of thing.
Found it interesting that the director of this episode is Michael Lange, and he has directed like a million different television shows, but one of the shows that he directed in the past before this was an episode of Buffy called Band Candy, which, as we discussed earlier, was written by Jane Espenson. So I imagine when Jane was hired to tie everything up, they asked her, are there any directors you've worked in the past with you like? And she put in a good word for him, and that's how he got in this. And there were some neat sweeping movements, not overly cinematic, but like moving from the bed to the door when Summer showed up to Seth's room. So it was cool, and I think he'll come back. Hey, actually, I accidentally read a spoiler on the Wikipedia that he does such a good job directing episodes that he eventually gets a part as a rabbi episode.
Oh, interesting.
So look out for...
The hell's that spoiler? It's just a casting thing.
There's going to be a rabbi. There's only a rabbi if there's one of three things. A wedding, someone dies, or a baby's dick gets cut.
Bar mitzvah.
So one of those three, or if it's all one three? Of four things, a wedding, a death, a baby dick, or a bar mitzvah. There are only four things that rabbis do.
Or a bat mitzvah, right?
There are one of five things that Michael Lange could be doing at this bar.
Ram you. That's true. I get how that...
Did you just turn into Summer?
Yes. Ew.
Ew. Bar ram, ew.
Bar ram, ew. To your fleece, your flock be true. Ram, ew.
That's kind of weird. There's actually a dip in ratings last for The Escape. It was the first time that the ratings went down.
After the cliffhanger?
Yeah, one from...
Watch out, Walking Dead.
Well, no, for the rescue went back up. So we went from 9.1 million down to 8.8 and then back up to 9.0 million.
Gotcha. So everyone caught the repeat. They were like, we don't need to watch this live.
But I guess if you're looking at it, like, I guess the girlfriend must have just bummed a lot of people out because that had the highest rating so far and then it took a dip after. So
the fuck
like,
happened to the girlfriend? Which one was that? Pedophilia. Oh, yeah, that one. Yeah. With the young lady. They were not into the young girlfriend for Caleb, I guess.
Or maybe Marissa losing her vampire cards.
Oh, that's true.
That's awesome. Is there anything else you want to talk about? That feels like a good wrap.
I would like to say that you should follow me on Twitter at WrestleManiaSC. I tweet sometimes about things. And you could also watch sketch comedy I make. Pasta Robot. Google it.
Google it.
Gargle it.
Jamie, where can we reach you?
You can tweet at me at Jamie Clark. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
If you would like to tweet us, the OC Men Podcast, you can find us at OC Men Podcast.
Or hit us up on Tumblr at ocmenpodcast.tumblr.com.
Or at Facebook, facebook.com/OC Men Podcast.
Facebook.
No, you're doing it wrong.
.uk.sex.
Okay, that's right.
Also, I'm JT and I like this show.
And we will.
Oh, see you later.
I forgot how the show works.